and we stopped that, and we concluded that with the promises that was given for the church at Ephesus. Now we are, coming to the church at Smyrna. So that means the church at Smyrna is the next, church that we are going to learn about. The church at Smyrna, that is from chapter 2, verses 8 through 11. And I believe that you already have gone through that portion. That means that you already read that portion, maybe chapter 2, verses 8 through 11. Now, we will read that portion. Only 4 verses are there. We will read that portion. Then we will discuss about all those things. Any one of you can read that portion now. Revelation chapter 2, verses 8 through 11.
And to the angel of the church in Smyrna, the words of the first and the last who died and came to life. And I know your tribulation and your poverty, but you are rich, and the slander of those who say that they are Jews are not, but the synagogue of Satan. Do not fear what you are about to suffer. Behold, the devil is about to throw some of you into prison, that you may be tested, and for 10 days you will have tribulation. Be faithful unto death, and I will give you the crown of life. He who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. The one who conquers will not be hurt by the second death.
Amen. So now we are going to learn about the church at Smyrna, which is from chapter 2, verses 8 to 11. And first of all, the point number A is the city where the church is located. The city where the church is located. So you can see a picture of the city of Smyrna. So you can see there in the slide. And we are going to listen about the specialities of that city of Smyrna. Okay, so there are a few points that I have written in the slide. You can just, note it down. At the same time, as soon as we are writing those points, I'll be explaining all those things, very shortly. Okay, so Smyrna was one of the most beautiful cities in Turkey. And Izmir is the present name of Smyrna. And the another point is, city is almost 35 miles away from Ephesus. So we have been learning about Ephesus. And now this city, the city of Smyrna, is almost 35 miles away from Ephesus. And there were many temples in that city. And this city was a port city and business center. And even in the city of Ephesus also, there were a famous stadium and library. In the city of Smyrna also, there was a stadium and also a library. And the next one is politically, religiously, and culturally. The city was prominent. That means the prominence of prominence in politics, religion, and culture. Okay, so it was very much known a city regarding the politics and the religion and the culture. And also, when we go to the history about the city of Smyrna, we understand that the city was formed in 1000 BC. So the city was formed in 1000 BC, but it was, destroyed in 600 BC by Medians. So this city was formed in 1000 BC, but it was destroyed in 600 BC by Medians. And also, this city has been known as the Ornament of Asia. There are 3 names given for the city of Smyrna. That is the Ornament of Asia, and the Crown of Asia, and the Flower of Asia. the ornament of Asia, the crown of Asia, and the flower of Asia. And especially the word Smyrna derived from the Greek word that is mirror. The Greek word which is used for Smyrna is mirror, M-Y-R-R-H, mirror, which means bitter, which means bitter. So this is the short explanation about the city of Smyrna. The reason that I already gave you the explanation about the city of Smyrna is when we move forward, we will be connecting all those points with the messages of the messages which was given for the church at church at Smyrna. Okay, so that is the point number A, and now we are going to the point number B. Point number B: the establishment of the church at Smyrna. The establishment of the church at Smyrna. That means, how was the church at Smyrna was established in that city, and who founded, who planted the church in Smyrna? That is the point. You know, actually, there is no report recorded in the Bible about how this church was founded, especially in the New Testament. Nothing is written about the foundation of the church at Smyrna. And who planned or who formed or how found this church or something. But history says some of the disciples of Paul, they came from Ephesus and planted the church at Smyrna, because, you know, Apostle Paul was visiting all these places, and Apostle Paul also visited and stayed in Smyrna. So we understand that some of the scholars are saying that it was some of the disciples of Apostle Paul. They came from Ephesus because Paul had many disciples in Ephesus, and Ephesus was a prominent church, and the Ephesus church was a well-known church for the missionary work and everything. So some scholars say that those disciples of Apostle Paul, they came to Smyrna and they planted the church. At the same time, it is believed that Paul himself planted the church at Smyrna, but there is no clear evidence about who established or who planned the church at Smyrna. Now, we will go to the third of C, point number C, that is the messages to the church at Smyrna. The messages to the church at Smyrna. So the letter to the church at Smyrna is the smallest letter of seven letters. There are only four verses. There are only four verses that we have read here. Okay, only four verses are there. In other messages to the churches, there are more than five or six verses are there. But this is the smallest letter of the seven letters. Only four verses are there. So this church was the most persecuted church. So we have to understand one thing. This church is famous for the persecution. And this church was the most persecuted church in Asia Minor. So most of the messages to the churches are given and are related to the geographical situation of that particular place or city. You know, when you go through the messages, which is written in chapters 2 and 3, most of the messages are related to some of the geographical situation of that particular place or that city. For example, you know, the word Smyrna. You know, here we see the name of the church is Smyrna. The word Smyrna is derived from the Greek word mirror. Okay, so we know that what is the mirror? What is the mirror? M-Y-R-R-H. What is that? In Malayalam, what is that? How many of you know the Malayalam of the word mirror? It is Kundirikam, Kundirikam. So it is well familiar with the Malayali people, you know, Kundirikam is that, okay? So this mirror is an object of fragrance or aroma. This is an object of fragrance or aroma. Okay, so mirror is a gum which gives the bitter taste. Okay, it's a gum which gives a bitter taste, and they used to make this perfume in a specific process. You know, when they are making this perfume, okay, there is a specific process to get that perfume or that what is that aroma. Okay, so you know, what they do is after taking the gum or the fluid or the chemical sap from the tree, you know, they are taking that sap or the fluid or the gum from the tree. You can see that tree now in the slide, the tree of mir. The mir tree is there in the slide. So this is the tree from where they are taking the fluid. They are taking the fluid and they are making it as a perfume. Okay, so and they are using that in different ways. So after taking the fluid from the tree, they will dry it and grind it and put it into the fire. Okay, after getting that fluid, they will just dry it and then grind it and put it into the fire. Then comes the sweet aroma when that fluid or when that sap is kept inside the fire. Then comes the sweet aroma. So this is the tree of myrrh. You can see in, especially there are many trees you can find in the city of myrrh. So now we will see what is the purpose of the tree of myrrh. Okay, the purposes which is given in the Bible, the purposes of the tree or the myrrh which is given in the Bible. There are many things written. So firstly, you can take it down. The first one is it was used in making perfume. It was used in making perfume. That is Psalms 45, verse 8. We are not going to read that verses because of the lack of time. So you can read it later and just write it down, the points. That's all. Okay, so I'll be just giving the points. So the first purpose of this myrrh was in Bible. It was used in making perfume. That we can see in Psalms 45, verse 8. And it was used in making oil. So in the Old Testament, Exodus chapter 30, verse 23, we read that this oil, which was made out of this tree or made out of the sap of this myrrh tree, it was used in the tabernacle of the Old Testament time. In the Old Testament time. And also, it was used in embalming the dead, maybe dead body. Okay, it was used in embalming the dead body. That is what we read in John chapter 19, verse 39, that Joseph of Arimathea used myrrh to embalm the body of Jesus. Joseph of Arimathea used the myrrh to embalm the body of Jesus. Again, it was used in the purification of woman. It was used in the purification of woman. That you can read in Esther chapter 2, verse 12. Esther chapter 2, verse 12. And also, it was used for relieving pain. It was used for relieving pain. That is in Mark chapter 15, verse 23. Mark chapter 15, verse 23. There we can see that before the crucifixion of Jesus, they gave the wine mingled with myrrh to Jesus. Okay, it is written like that. So they gave the wine mingled with the myrrh to Jesus. So that is what, you know, It was simply given for Jesus to relieve his pain. Okay, so that's what we read in Mark chapter 15, verse 23. And also, when you read Matthew chapter 2, Matthew chapter 2, verse 11, there we see the wise men brought the gold, then frankincense and myrrh, and presented before the body, before the baby Jesus when they came to see the baby. That is in Matthew chapter 2, verse 11. Okay, they brought gold, frankincense, and myrrh, and they presented that before the baby Jesus when they were coming to see and meet Jesus Christ. And also, there is another way you can say that this myrrh was used for the purification and the perfumery. Purification also and the perfume. It was a perfume. I told you that there were many myrrh trees in Smyrna. You know, when we cut the skin of the tree, we get the sap out of it. We get a sap out of it, and that is the thing which brings the fragrance. Okay, that is the thing which brings the fragrance. So to get the myrrh, the tree must go through the pain. So that is the meaning of that. You know, to get the, smell, or to get the myrrh, to get the perfume, that that tree must go through the pain. So there is a blessing, and there is a smell is coming out of this thing after the pain. So the church of Smyrna is known as the most persecuted church, and even in verse 10 we read about the prophecy of persecution. Okay, we read about the prophecy of persecution in verse 10 even. So we'll be looking into that later. Okay, now we will go to the next point, is the appreciations. You can give the number A, appreciations. That is from chapter 2, verse 9. Chapter 2, verse 9 says, I know your tribulation and your poverty, but you are rich. And the blasphemy by those who say they are Jews and are not, but are a synagogue of Satan. Okay. So that is the verse, no? So in verse 9, God said, I know your affliction or your pain or your persecution. Okay. When God is trying to appreciate church at Ephesus also, he was appreciating them for their good work and their effort and their toil, okay? Their, hard work and everything. So there are many points which is written in the messages to the Ephesus also. I know. Same thing is written in the messages of Smyrna. That is a kind of appreciation for the believers of the church. Okay, so what is that? I know your affliction. That means God knows the affliction. God knows the pain that the church was going through. God knows the persecution, that the severe persecution that the church at Smyrna was going through. Now, we will see the afflictions of church at Smyrna. What are the afflictions that the church at Smyrna was going through? Okay, it is very easy to understand. You know, we have to go to those points. There are three kinds of afflictions and persecutions that the church in Smyrna was going through. Three types of afflictions are there. So if you're writing down, then you can just write it down then. The afflictions of church in Smyrna. The first one is the political leaders. That means the Roman emperors. The political leaders, Roman emperors, or you can call it as a king. For example, Julius Caesar and Nero and Domitian and all those people, all those emperors, those were persecuting the Christians in those days. So the first affliction or first persecution comes to the Christianity from the political leaders or the Roman emperors. You know what happened? When these people, these emperors were ruling over the over that place, that empire, we understand that they promoted the emperor worship and they said to the people that you should worship them. Okay, that means the people, not only the Christians, all the people of that area or the city, they were compelled to worship the emperors. So they were promoting the emperor worship. So what happened? Christians refused to worship the emperors because they were knowing that there is a God who is alive. I mean, there is a God and we are not supposed to worship any human being of this world. So that kind of idea and that kind of faith they had, the Christians in those days, you know, they were knowing that we should not worship any of the idol. We should not worship any of the human being, but we should worship only the living God. So Christians refused to worship the emperors. Then, because of that reason, the Christians on those days, they were persecuted. So that is the first affliction, or that is the first persecution that the Christians were getting, I mean, from the political leaders or the Roman emperors. Now, we will go to the second one, second affliction that they had. That was from the native people, the natives. That means, you know, they were hated. The Christians were hated only because of the Romans and Roman emperors hated them. You know, there were many native people where the believers were staying. In Smyrna, there were many native people from different religion, But what happened? I mean, the natives or the neighbors of these Christians or these believers, they were also hating Christians. There was no reason for that, but only because the Romans and the Roman emperors were hating them. Okay, so without any reason, they were hated. In John chapter 15, verse 18, you read that verse. John chapter 15, verse 18. Who can read? John 15, 18.
If the world hates you, keep in mind that it hated me first.
Praise God. Amen. So, you know, Bible very clearly says that even Jesus said, if the world hates you, okay, no, don't be worried about that because the world already hated me. Okay. The world hated me first. Then you also will be facing those problems. You also will be having the persecution. You also will be facing the hatredness. So there is no problem. Even if you are facing that problem, I mean, you just believe that, just know something that Jesus already, I mean, hated from all of the people and also even from his own people, the Jewish people. Okay. So it is a common thing that, okay, we will be hated by the natives. So we have many native people and we have many neighbors and everybody will not agree with us and everybody will not accept us and they may be rejecting us, they may be speaking something opposite to us, but no worries because already the people rejected Jesus Christ. Now, we will go to the third affliction of the Christians, especially the Christians of Smyrna, that is the Jews. That means the Jewish religion, because the Jewish religion couldn't accept Christians and Christ also. Why? They were expecting Messiah. So they were expecting Messiah means the Jewish people or Jewish religion were expecting a political leader for them because those people, the Jewish people were scattered into different countries. So they were expecting a political leader to bring them all together in Israel and to establish the kingdom. So that's the reason that they, the Jewish people did not, most of the Jewish people did not accept Jesus Christ, and they did not accept Christians also. So, because of this reason, Jews supported Romans to crucify Christ. Okay, you know, actually, Romans were, the Roman Empire was crucifying Jesus. At the same time, the Jewish people were supporting them. Jewish people were supporting them. Means, you know, they said, crucify him, crucify Jesus, because this Jesus is not our Messiah, you crucify them. So this is the one reason that the Jewish people were persecuting and supporting the Roman people to persecute the Christians. These are the three kinds of afflictions and the persecutions that the church at Smyrna was going through. Now, we will go to the next point, that is, I know your poverty. I know your poverty. That also in the same verse, verse 9, says, I know your tribulation and your poverty, but you are rich. I know your poverty. There are mainly two suggestions among scholars about this situation of church at Smyrna. Okay, here, God says that, I know your poverty. That means you are very poor. You are very poor. I know that. Okay. At the same time, he says that, but you are rich. We'll go to that point. So there are mainly two suggestions about this point, why God is saying that, I know your poverty. The first one is, the believers were from a financially poor background. You know, this is the first suggestion, or such, you can call it as a first opinion, that the believers were from a financially poor background. So that is the one reason, maybe, that God is saying that, I know your poverty. And the second reason is, second opinion is, they were very rich before knowing Jesus. But after coming to Christianity, they lost everything and they became very poor people. You got the point? You know, they were rich people before coming to Christ, before knowing Jesus Christ and accepting Jesus Christ, Christianity. But after coming to the Christianity, they lost everything and they became very poor. And there are reasons for that. There are reasons for that. I will try to explain that. You know, most of them were business people. You know, the believers and the people, those who were living in the city, especially in Smyrna, you know, they were all having the business. So they were the business people. So to do the business, the history says that to do the business, everyone must have an agreement with the Roman Empire and have to consider Caesar as their god. You know, I already told you that the emperors were, promoting and compelling the people to worship them. Same thing is happening here. Now, they had an agreement with the Roman Empire, and they were saying that if you want to do the business, if you want to continue the business, and if you want to earn the money, then you will have to consider Caesar, Julius Caesar, as the god. Otherwise, there is no permission to do the business. But for the Jewish people, there was a concession. Only for the Jewish people, there was a concession that if they don't worship Caesar, no problem, but should agree with all other regulations. There were many other agreements and regulations, but only for the Jewish people, the Roman Empire gave a concession that if they don't worship Caesar, no problem, leave it, but you have to agree with all other rules and regulations. But Christians disagreed with the command of Julius Caesar worship. Christians could not agree with that. They said, we will not worship you. We will not worship Caesar. We cannot do that. So what happened? They lost the permission to do the business. And what happened? Many people and many believers became jobless. They became jobless. They became like beggars and had to experience a kind of poverty in their life. Okay, so this is the situation of the believers of church at Smyrna. So that may be the reason that, I mean, God is saying that, I know your poverty. I know your poverty. Amen. But God said in verse 9, I know your poverty, but you are rich. Same thing. Okay. The second point is, you are rich. That means you are rich in spirit. Financially, you are poor. I know that. But spiritually, you are rich. Amen. Hallelujah. So whenever they were losing the job, and whenever they were losing the business, and whenever they were going down and down financially and in all other material things and everything, they were trusting in the Lord. They were believing in God and worshiping God and praying. And they were spiritually very rich. That's the reason God said, I know you were your poverty. At the same time, I know that you are rich in spirit. You are rich in spirit. And I pray this evening also that God say about everyone of us, that in many ways you may be poor, but you have to be rich in spirit. Rich in spirit means we have to worship God, and we have to be active in all the spiritual activities, and reading Bible, praying and worshiping, and sharing the gospel, preaching and sharing the word of God. In every realms of the spiritual activities, we must be very active, and we must be spiritually rich in every areas of our life. Amen. Now we will go to the next appreciation of God towards the church at Smyrna. Next appreciation. So what was the first appreciation? What was that? I know your affliction, or I know your pain, or I know your persecution. And second one was, I know your poverty. At the same time, you are rich in spirit. Praise God. And now we will go to the next appreciation. That is, I know the slander or blasphemy of those who say they are Jews but are not Jews. They are from the synagogue of Satan. Same verse 9. What is that? And the blasphemy by those who say they are Jews but are not Jews, but are a synagogue of Satan. That means a group of people. Okay. The synagogue means in Malayalam it is written, the verse 9 is, Nyanthinte Kashtadiyum Daridryavum Nee Dhanavanakunnu Thaanum Thangal Yahoodar Ennu Parayunnengilum യഹൂദരല്ല സാത്താന്റെ പള്ളിക്കാരായവരുടെ ദൂഷണം നീ അറിയുന്നു. ദൂഷണം, സോ സ്ലാൻഡർ ആൻഡ് ബ്ലാസ്ഫമി ഇൻ മലയാളം ഇറ്റ് ഈസ് റിട്ടൺ ദൂഷണം. സോ ദാറ്റ് ഈസ് ഇറ്റ്സ് എ സിനഗോഗ് ഓഫ് സേറ്റർ, സാത്താന്റെ പള്ളിക്കാർ എന്നാണ്. സാത്താന്റെ പള്ളിക്കാർ, സിനഗോഗ് ഓഫ് സേറ്റർ. ഓക്കെ. നൗ ദിങ് ദാറ്റ് വി അണ്ടർസ്റ്റാൻഡ് ഫ്രം ദിസ് പോയിന്റ് ഈസ് ദ അക്യൂസേഷൻ ആൻഡ് ദ ബിട്രേയൽ ഓൺ ക്രിസ്ത്യൻസ് ബൈ ജൂയിഷ് പീപ്പിൾ. നോ, the Jewish people were accusing many things about Christians, and they were betraying on Christians, and that is what we understand. Even though they are known as the Jewish people, but they are influenced by Satan. Some of the people, for example, some of the history says that some of the Jewish people, they were supporting the Romans, and they were always accusing the Christians. And they were saying that, okay, these people, the Christians, are not the Jewish people. The Christians are following Jesus, and we don't believe in Jesus, and you can persecute them. So they were supporting them. So that is what we read. So that is the reason that God says that, there are some people, they are calling themselves as the Jewish people, but they are influenced by Satan. That's the reason those people are, standing against the Christianity. Amen? Now, we will go to the next appreciation of God towards the church at Smyrna. That is, I know your future tribulation. I know your future tribulation. That is in chapter 2, verse 10. chapter 2, verse 10. Do not fear what you are about to suffer. Behold, the devil is about to cast some of you into prison so that you will be tested. And you will have tribulation for 10 days. Be faithful until death, and I will give you the crown of life. This is a kind of appreciation for the church at Smyrna. A kind of appreciation for the church at Smyrna. This is a future prophecy about the church at Smyrna. It is little difficult to understand, is it an appreciation or not? But let me tell you one thing. This is an appreciation that God says that in future, you will have some tribulation. In future, you will have some tribulation. This is a prophecy. At the same time, the prophecy is you will have suffering. You will have suffering. And the devil will, or the Satan will, cast some of you in prison. You will be tested. You will have tribulation for 10 days. You will have tribulation for 10 days. You know, especially it is written that you will have the tribulation for 10 days. That particular usage, there are different opinions, but we can conclude at that point like this is maybe the period of time from the time of Emperor Domitian to the time of Diocletian. Okay, from the time of Emperor Domitian to the time of Diocletian, there are 10 emperors. There are 10 emperors from this time to that time. There are mainly 10 emperors. So that may be the reason that God is saying to the church at Smyrna that in the future, there will be 10 more emperors that they will persecute you, okay? And they will do all kinds of evil to you, and they will, put you in prison, and they will test you, and you will have the tribulation for 10 days. Yeah, maybe we cannot say that, okay, 10 days, that particular phrase, what is the meaning of that, but we can assume that that may be the meaning that many emperors are coming in future, and they are going to persecute you. So, let me ask you one thing this evening as we are listening to this word. If we get this prophecy, a prophecy like this, okay, and somebody is prophesying to you that, okay, you are going to have the persecution in the coming days, and you will have something to suffer, you will have the suffering, and you are going to suffer many things, and when some of you will be cast into the prison, and some of you will be becoming the martyrs, or somebody will be, something is going to happen to you, okay? And what would be our response? What would be our response? You know, we are always expecting all kinds of comfort, but if something happens which we never expect, what would be our response? Always we are expecting, okay, everything should be comfortable. And everything should be, calm and quiet, without any trouble, without any suffering, without any problem. Let us go like this. Amen. But if there is a prophecy coming to you and saying that, okay, this is going to happen for you, and you will suffer something, you will have to suffer for the sake of Christ, and you will have the tribulation, you will have the suffering, then what would be our response this evening? Let me tell you one thing, that the coming in the coming days, you know, the coming days won't be the that comfortable for Christians. The things are changing, and there are many differences happening, and they have many trials and tribulations and afflictions in the coming days. You know, but we have to think about how strong is our faith. You know, for example, when you go to India, you know, in India there are many persecutions that are happening now, increasing in different places, especially in North India and in Karnataka and everywhere. You know, there are many churches, there are many believers are persecuted. In these days, you know, the central government is dead against the Christians and Muslims. You know, something is happening there. You know, there are many people, going through the persecution. and sufferings and everything. So let us think about what is going to happen in the coming days. When nothing will be comfortable. I mean, there are many problems ahead of us, but we have to be strong. I mean, we have to be strong and firm in faith in our Christian lives. Amen. So remember, the sufferings will help us to experience. Whenever we go through the suffering, that will help us to experience the presence of God, and that will purify our Christian life and will lead us to eternity. So we have to, expect anything, and we have to be, strongly follow Jesus Christ and His word in the coming days. So may God bless you for that. And when you study about the messages to the church at Smyrna, there is nothing is written. Any weak points are mentioned in this church. You listen that verses, only 4 verses are there. There is no weakness. Nothing is mentioned. No weakness or weak point is mentioned in that portion. Nothing is there. But there is a warning. There is no weak points. Just like Ephesus. What was the weak point of church at Ephesus? They lost their first love. First love is very important. They lost their first love. But here, there is no weak points is mentioned, but we will go to the warning. Point number B, warning. Chapter 2, verse 10. Chapter 2, verse 10, warning. What is that? Do not fear what you are about to suffer. Behold, the devil is... Okay, that is over. Then, be faithful until death, and I will give you the crown of life. Be faithful until death, and I will give you the crown of life. Okay. Not only in 10 verse. Yeah, verse 10 and verse 11. Okay, 2 verses are there. Okay, in verse 10, chapter 2, verse 10, what is that? Be faithful until the death. Be faithful until the death. That is the warning. And second one is overcome. Overcome. In verse 1, he who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. He who overcomes will not be hurt by the second death. That means there are mainly 2 warnings given to the believers at Smyrna church. What was that? Be faithful until the death and overcome. So faithfulness is one of the most important factors of the fulfillment of the promise. God is giving the promise towards us, but at the same time, we must be faithful in the sight of God. If we are not faithful, we are not going to get the promise which is given for us by God. Amen. So be faithful towards God. Be faithful towards people. Each moment of our life, and overcome the worldly pleasures every moment through prayer and through trusting in the Holy Spirit, the power of the Holy Spirit, we will be able to be faithful and also to overcome the pleasures of this world. Now, we will go to the next point number C, that is the promise of reward. The promise of reward. The promise of reward is also from chapter 2, verses 10 and 11. Chapter 2, verses 10 and 11. There are mainly 2 promises. There are many through rewards are there. The number one is the crown of life. I'll read once again that verse, then we'll move on. Do not fear what you are about to suffer. Behold, the devil is about to cast some of you into prison so that you will be tested. And you will have the tribulation of 10 days. Be faithful until the death, and I will give you the crown of life. And again, 11th verse. He who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. He who overcomes will not be hurt by the second death. 2 rewards are there. Number one, the crown of life. And the second one is he will not be hurt by the second death. So both of these things, both of these promises, both of these rewards speaks about the eternal deliverance and the eternal blessings It's not the temporary deliverances, temporary blessings or something, because we are praying for the temporary deliverance always. No, whenever we are sick, we'll pray for the church, will pray for you, and may God will bless you, and God may deliver you. So that is a common thing, you know. In this temporary world, we are getting the blessings from the Lord, physical or material blessings or something. But the things that the promise which is offered here is not related to this world, but that is related to the eternal life. That means both of them is speaking about the eternal deliverance and the eternal blessings. You know, there are five crowns mentioned in the Bible as a reward. You know, so in Bible itself, in New Testament, there are mainly five crowns are there mentioned in the Bible. This one here, he is mentioning the crown of life. The crown of life that is offered for the martyrs. Okay, the crown which is mentioned here and offered for the church at Smyrna is for the martyrs, the people, those who were suffering, and the people, those who were dying for the name of Jesus. Okay, those people are going to get the crown of life in heaven. No, the other ones are the crown of righteousness, and the incorruptible crown is there, and crown of glory is there, and crown of rejoicing is there, all those things. And this is the one mentioned here, that is the crown of life, that is for the people, those who are martyrs. So remember one thing, you know, in this world we have pain, and we have sickness, you know, we have sufferings, we have tears, but in the world to come, there is no pain. In that world, there is no sickness, there is no suffering, there is no tears. Always, always, we are enjoying in the presence of God. Always, we are worshiping God. Okay. So, but we read here about the second death in this particular verse. You know, the people, those who are overcoming the worldly pleasures, will for them, the second death will not hurt them. The second death will not hurt them. So we will go to Revelation chapter 20, verses 14 and 15. There we can understand what is the second death. You know, if a person is overcoming the world, that the second death will not hurt that person. Okay, so what is the second death? That is very clearly written in Revelation chapter 20, verses 14 and 15. Can anyone read?
Then the death and Hades were thrown into the lake of fire. This is the second death, the lake of fire. And if anyone's name was not found written in the book of life, he was thrown into the lake of fire.
So it is written there, second death is the lake of fire. Second death is the lake of fire. I will explain that. The physical death is applicable for everyone. The physical death is applicable for everyone. But if you are a born-again person, the second death will not hurt you. That means there is no second death for a person who is born again. That means if you are a born-again person, if you are a born-again person, if you are a believer, if you are a child of God, nothing to worry, that you will not have a second death. What is the second death? The lake of fire. But if you are a born-again person, you don't worry about the lake of fire. But if you are not a born-again person, absolutely you can wait for the lake of fire. So we are so glad that God is giving us the opportunity to become a born-again person and saved person and a child of God. Then we have nothing to be worried about the lake of fire or the second one. Okay. So let us cling upon the eternal promises of God and faithfully serve the Lord, in this world. Hallelujah. You know, one of the writer, his name is, Alistair Beck. Alistair Beck is the name of a writer, and he gave a particular quotation. You know, he said like this, there is a kind of life leads to the death. There is a kind of life leads to the death. And there is a kind of death that leads to the life. This is very important to understand. There is a kind of life leads to the death. Okay? So some people are going to the death. Their ultimate, destiny is the death. And there is a kind of death that leads to the life. Okay? When we die in this world, that will lead us to the life, the eternal life. Eternal life. We are not, going for a temporary life, and we are waiting for the eternal life. And we need the second one. Okay, we need the second one. What is the second one? What is the second one? Born again experience, and we will go to the eternal life. The death which leads us to the eternal life. The death which leads us to the eternal life. You know, let me tell you about one person, one martyr. You know, his name is Polycarp. Okay, his name is Polycarp, the martyrdom of Polycarp. You know, that's a history. History says that after John, Pastor Polycarp, he became the leader and the minister of the Smyrna church. After John, he was the person who took charge of the Smyrna church, and in his 86th year, Roman government caught him and sentenced to death. And he was waiting for his martyrdom. But one of the Roman officials secretly told him, "Hey, old man, you just deny Jesus, then you can get released from this martyrdom." He was an 86 years old a man, and he was a leader. He was a minister of the Smyrna church, and this man, the Roman official, was saying that, okay, secretly he said that, okay, you just deny Jesus, then you can be released from this martyrdom. You don't want to die. Yeah, just relieve, just to say that, okay, I don't know Jesus and I don't believe in Jesus. But Polycarp answered like this: "God has been good to me for last 86 years. This is very important. His reply is very important. God has been good to me for last 86 years, and he never denied me so far. He never denied me so far. Whenever I went to Jesus, he spoke to me and he comforted me and he was with me. His presence is with me always. He never denied me so far. Then how can I deny Jesus? How can I deny Jesus?" This is the question that Polycarp answered to those people, Roman Empire. Hallelujah. You know, this officer repeatedly said, "He just denied Jesus," but he did not deny Jesus, but he testified about Jesus and became a martyr for Christ. He was looking forward for the crown of life. He was looking forward for the crown of life. Hallelujah. So this evening, let me tell you, let me encourage every one of you, that even though there are many troubles in our life, even though there are many problems in our life, even though there are sufferings in our life, hallelujah, do not be worried about anything. Do not be, what is a disgrace? Don't give up anything, but let's all, worship God, and let's all trust in the Lord. Let us say the Lord, even though I have the problems and sufferings and afflictions in this world, I'm waiting for the crown of life. Hallelujah. I know that I have a crown of life. I have a crown of righteousness, and I have a crown of glory in heaven. We are waiting for that. Hallelujah. So let us all, submit ourselves in the mighty hand of God, just like the Smyrna church. No, the Smyrna church, even though they were going through the troubles in their life, just like Polycarp, even though he was going to be sentenced to the death. Amen. He was replying, and he had something special to say, that I cannot deny Jesus. This evening, let me encourage every one of you, do not deny Jesus, whatever you suffer, whatever the problem, whatever the persecution that you are going through. Trust in the Lord, believe in Jesus Christ, trust him alone, and God will provide all the needs of your heart. Hallelujah. And may God bless you all, through these verses. And now we will, pray and conclude this class. Then after that, I'll give you maybe 10 minutes or something. to ask any doubt or any question,